My name's Angel.
LA's my territory. You want to stay out of it for the rest of your eternal lives. These kids, my town, off limits from now on.
Angel was spun off of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, of course. One day, Joss Whedon came to me and said, what do you think about making our own show with David Boreanaz as Angel? And I said, I think it's a fabulous idea, and I think we should team him up with Charisma Carpenter, who plays Cordelia. We imagined a dark, gritty, urban show, and what had been the metaphors of people in their teens, the angst of adolescence, became, in our show, people in their 20s in the big, bad, scary city. We felt very strongly it was a show that could stand on its own two feet, and pretty soon we had a commitment to put some shows on the air.
Understanding what the responsibilities of, you know, taking on your own show and the lead of your own show and what that all means. Coming from a cast of people on Buffy that were so great to work with, and then all of a sudden just leaving that family after three seasons. It was difficult, but was perfect for a change right now for his character to evolve and see what he can do in a bigger city.
Los Angeles. You see it at night, and it shines. A beacon. People are drawn to it. People and other things. Come for all sorts of reasons. My reason? No surprise there. It started with a girl.
Angel is a dark show about a man looking for redemption. We have an alcoholic metaphor with Angel. Angel's a guy who's one drink away from going back to his evil roots. And what makes the show interesting is it encompasses so many different genres. We have drama, horror, comedy.
It started out in the first episode, we're getting a message from this kind of strange Irishman, demon, and going forward from there and kind of mixing it up with humans, which he really can't do. He finds it difficult to be around humans early on in the first part of the season.
Are you, happy?
What?
I was looking towards there, and you walked through there.
You don't hit on girls very often, do you?
It's been a while. I'm sort of new in town.
Do yourself a favor. Don't stay.
City established for me a couple of very key things. One, that Angel leaps in the wrong car while he's in the middle of saving the girl. Another, that he can be sort of sweet and hangdog and vulnerable. He has to learn how to relate to other people.
Okay, first thing, we need to call an exterminator. And a sign painter. We should have a name on the door.
Along with his co-stars and his friends on the show, they all kind of came together and formed a team, kind of like Detective Agency, and fight these demons in Los Angeles that everybody's possessed with.
If you're in trouble, just call this number. We can help. Hi. Being harassed by someone or something? Dial us up day or night.
I loved Room with a View because it was a very simple story about the first apartment you get on your own.
You know what? I get it. You're a ghost. You're dead. Big accomplishment. Move on. You see a light anywhere? Go towards it.
Something in there is trying to kill her and trying desperately to get her out. And she says, I would rather die than leave this apartment. And I like that show a lot, too, because I thought that was a great metaphor for getting your first place.
Look, I know what this looks like.
So do I.
I know there was a lot of squawk on the internet among the fans that we were creating Kate as a love interest for Angel, which is not really true.
I just have a hard time, you know, trusting people. Male people particularly. In a place like this, it's not like anybody's gonna come up and show you who they really are.
I think by establishing me in the very beginning as somebody who had a lot of loneliness, there's a big barrier with, you know, that type of aspect in your personality. She's distrusting, she's been hurt, she doesn't quite know how to communicate with people. And the first episode I ever did in the first season, which was called Lonely Hearts, really outlined that.
It's frustrating, isn't it? Not being able to connect, to love like other people. I mean, how do you get him to trust you, Angel? Give him the big dark eyes, the I'm not good with talk speech.
It's much more predictable to make, you know, the young ingenue become the female love interest, but it's, you know, less predictable for it to be his enemy.
It seemed that the fans warmed to Kate the moment she found out what Angel was and threatened his life. And certainly it becomes a more interesting dynamic that she's not seeing the ambiguity of a vampire with a soul. All she's seeing is, you are a monster. There are monsters in the world. You have forced me to see that fact. I am angry at you for that. I am angry at you for what you are. I am angry at you because of your past, which she discovers on her own. And I am angry at you because I can't really date you now.
I know that what happened with your father.
My father was human. And you don't know anything about that.
There was an opportunity after the 10th episode to bring in a new character. And Joss and David decided that they had loved Wesley's character so much that this was the guy to bring back.
Hello, Angel.
Wesley.
I'll wager you never thought you'd see me again.
Tell you the truth, I hadn't given it much thought one way or the other.
What do you... Up. I'm the one asking questions here.
The show had a real focus and the real relationship between Angel and Cordelia and Wesley.
It's part of the rich tapestry of how our creators, Joss and David, weave the world. And they're constantly attempting to challenge and upset the equilibrium. And then as a result of that, when balance is achieved, it's stronger as a result of the differences.
I don't care how many files you have on all the horrible things that he did back in the powdered wig days. He is good now, and he is my friend, and nothing you or anyone else can say will make me turn on a friend.
Cordelia, he's right.
You stake him and I'll cut his head off.
As their relationship grows, they find that he's also becoming part of the team. Doesn't want to leave LA because he wants to stay and fight demons.
I don't suppose you need any help slaying the big baby creature, do you? Not that an evening alone with word puzzle isn't plenty exhilarating in its own right. Right.
I mean, they brought the character of Wesley in. Everything started to gel.
Oh, my God. Faith.
I thought she was in a coma.
Pretty lively coma.
We did several crossover episodes the first year and married some of the Buffy characters into the Angel universe, and they were really fun. We brought Spike in one episode, and he was fantastic.
You think you can come to my town and pull this crap? Never learn, Spike.
I may be a slow learner, but... eventually I catch up.
And we did an episode where Buffy visited called I Will Remember You.
Friend of yours?
Never saw it before.
It was rude. We should go kill it.
I'm free.
Buffy comes to L.A. and Angel is made human. And in fact, their love can be a real love because he won't go evil if he knows her in the biblical sense. And he got to look at a reflection of himself for the first time. He got to eat food.
This is a dream. You're human for like a minute and already there's cookie dough fudge mint chip in the fridge.
God, I love food.
Food is good.
In the end, of course, he went to the powers that be and got them to turn back time so that Buffy would never know that they had had this perfect love for a day.
That was so cool. This is gonna be fun.
Eliza Dushku, who plays Faith, sort of the renegade rebel slayer, came to the show in 5x5, in which she hires herself out to Wolfram and Hart to kill Angel.
Here's the target. Don't let the picture fool you. She's tougher than she looks.
Help me?
Yeah.
In Sanctuary, where she tries to atone for her sins, and only Angel can help her atone for her sins, because only Angel knows the levels to which she's sunk, the way that she has suffered in her soul, and he kind of brings her back to a semblance of humanity.
Some clever stuff, really. I'm impressed. But I have a few suggestions.
Don't think we're interested.
Yeah. You should be. Who do you think that would have killed?
When Gunn arrived, that was a great character and a great show for him, but also just nice for the world to expand again and be challenged again.
Charles Gunn is a character that we meet living on the street. He is a guardian to his sister. At the time when we meet him in the War Zone episode, he has organized this huge army to combat the vampires who are feeding off of his homeless brethren, if you will. Angel comes into the picture, and, you know, I've never even heard of the concept of a good vampire. That's like something just completely unbelievable to me. So I assume he's one of the bad guys, and I kind of go after him. But then by the end of the episode, he helps me in a way that I realize he actually is a good person.
Oh, say goodbye to everything you ever knew.
I think the dynamic that Gunn brings to the team is he's an incredible fighter, and he has taught himself all of these things. He's a self-taught vampire hunter. He's also very, very loyal and very protective.
My people, they're in the hospital, St. Matthews. One's in ICU, one's in the neuropsychiatric unit. They need protection while I hunt down the guy who put them there.
He won't come for him himself or send someone.
Wherever he comes, he's not gonna get him. These people mean a lot to me.
I'm getting that.
As the year progresses, we learn new things about the characters as we write the shows, or we take some turn we didn't expect to take, and then that changes what's happening through the rest of the year.
We're all very pleased you're here. I know it's a bit confusing, but it's going to be better soon. A lot better, Darla.